It's been a long time, but we're back. You're listening to the Lions Sports Talk. It's our NFL Draft Edition, April 24th, 2018. Draft week, I used to refer to this as Jamarcus Russell Day. Thankfully, I don't have to look at it that way anymore. Joining me tonight is the Draft Master himself, Mike from FootballTalkDaily365.com. You can find him on Twitter at FTD365. Mike, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Glad to be here.
I know you are. You are a you're a draft nut, man. I've never seen anybody really put this much time into a draft that didn't have a paycheck to follow it. So let's get into it, man. This is one of the more exciting times of the year for an NFL season. But in years past, some of these drafts haven't been great. This one looks like it's got just a lot of surprise, a lot of spy tech going on. There's just a lot of different things happening. And I think that we're in for a treat Thursday night. At least I hope so. I hope there's a good storyline, man. But the obvious move right away, you've got the Cleveland Browns that are on the clock. The Browns at number one overall have been, they 0-16 last year. They've been a laughing stock. This is not a team anybody's really looked at going into a season and saying, wow, there's potential for this team to be good. Anybody with a realistic outlook. And now this year, with all the moves, with the addition of John Dorsey, who in my eyes is a GM who knows exactly what he's doing, he took the reins away from a guy like Jimmy Haslam, who doesn't know a damn thing about football, in my other opinion. The Cleveland Browns, on the clock. You're the master, man. Tell me what you see happening.
So, we've been hearing there's three guys in the mix. Everyone's saying, especially in the past week or so, every day it's either, oh, no, Josh Allen's the guy, Sam Darnold's the guy, Baker Mayfield's the guy. I don't buy all that noise. I don't think they're leaking the picks or anything, but I do think that, we saw the owner go up to Sam Darnold's parents at his pro day and talk to him for, 30 minutes?
Sure. Wasn't he, he was signing Browns jerseys and giving them to Darnold's family?
Yeah, those have come out too, yeah. So, I think it's always been there all along. And, if I'm Cleveland, I don't want to give away my pick. Let everybody else behind me, freak out. Oh, who am I going to get? Because obviously we know there's going to be a huge war on quarterbacks in the top five.
Sure.
And that's what's going to make this so fun. Last year at this time, they didn't come out with it, but we knew they were taking Myles Garrett. I think they're doing us all a favor by keeping it a secret. I think they're making it more fun for us.
Do you think
that we're glued to Twitter?
Yeah. So somehow this is some sort of plot by the NFL and by these teams to just keep – the NFL has done a tremendous job of making this a 24-hour job. They've done they make this 24-hour, 7 days a week in a 12-month out-of-the-year league. So this is just another example of them making this awesome.
Oh, yeah. Every morning I'm getting up looking at some NFL draft rumors and – they're changing every day, but, kudos to them. It's just a lot of fun, but I think Sam Darnold's going to be the guy. I think he's the best. I think he's the safest quarterback in this class. Josh Allen, he's got the big arm, but he doesn't have the most accurate arm. And I think that somebody like Sam Darnold, I think he's a safer pick. I think he's the guy you got to go with because you've been searching for 19 years now.
It's been that long. And I got to tell you, the Cleveland Browns, John Dorsey, Hugh Jackson, of all people, they cannot afford to whiff on this pick. I'm not afraid to spend a little time talking about the number one overall here because it's not cut and dried like it was last year with Myles Garrett. Who was the other option potentially last year?
They were saying Trubisky, but...
Yeah, that's right.
That
wasn't really an option, I don't think. And I think that...
No, they were just putting that out there.
And you may hear a little bit about this and a little bit about that just to juggle it around. I haven't heard the name Josh Rosen associated with the Cleveland Browns at all.
I think you can chalk that up to, everyone's saying injury concerns. He was kind of banged up in college. They don't know how that's going to translate.
Sure.
Yeah. And then also, I don't think any NFL team loves the outspoken opinions, as we've seen with Colin Kaepernick still sitting on the free agent wire from a quarterback.
You're right.
They don't want that in a quarterback. So I think that's going to do something to it. Don't get me wrong. He's a good passer. People think he's going to fall, but I don't see him leaving the top 7 to 8 picks. So, yeah, he's going to fall a little bit, and I think that's part of the reason you don't hear his name in there. Because a guy like that, he's not going to work in Cleveland. He plays warm weather. Arizona would be a good fit, I think.
Well,
Miami, warm weather.
Yeah.
I think that's a better fit for him.
He's a Central California kid. I don't disagree. I think that you are probably right with Sam Darnold being the number one overall pick in this draft. I don't know that I love it. I also don't know that any of these quarterbacks, the more and more I've looked at this, you know, and I'll keep using Andrew Luck as an example, although when we get to the Colts pick, we're going to talk a little bit about his situation too. But I look at Andrew Luck and I as the number one overall pick years ago, and I keep remembering when Andrew Luck was at Stanford watching him and going, boy, this guy's got everything. He's a guy that can step in, play right now. He's ready to go. He's got everything you want. And I thought that Andrew Luck was the clear-cut number one overall pick. There was no questions asked. I thought, and he was so fortunate to be able to, you know, lose Peyton and bring this kid on board and not miss a beat. And there hasn't been a quarterback since for me in the number one slot that I've looked at and gone, yeah, this guy's a can't miss. This is the guy you want. There just hasn't been that guy. Jameis Winston is a number one overall pick. I just didn't see him being an Andrew Luck. Who was the other number one overall pick in recent years here as a quarterback?
Well, Jared Goff.
Thank you. Between Goff and Wentz.
You can even throw in Wentz, too. I mean, I would say that those guys, like, those are cool. I mean, looking back, there was no reason to think they wouldn't be successful in the NFL, and
right.
They landed in very good situations with good offensive-minded head coaches, with Doug Peterson for Wentz and Goff, Scott, Sean McVay, and that's what people don't realize the biggest thing. It's all about the right situation.
I think you're right.
A stable coach, a coach who knows how to use the skill set of each player, which that's one thing for sure. Darnold, Allen, Mayfield, Rosen, they're all way different passers. They're not the same, and it's all about scheme fit in the NFL for success. And another big thing is you got to protect the quarterback, give him weapons. And I don't know. I don't see Allen the fit. I see Darnold. And then if it's not Darnold, I think Mayfield's could be off the board at one.
I do too. I think it's a real possibility. I'm going to leave you with this thought on this number one overall pick, and then we'll move on to two. But when you mentioned coaches and using skill sets, Hugh Jackson was wildly successful, and well, I don't want to say wildly successful, that's overblown, but he was successful with Andy Dalton. If Cleveland takes Sam Darnold number one overall and he is Andy Dalton, it's a bust.
I mean, don't forget, Andy Dalton has, I'll just throw that out. I'll argue that, but I see what you're saying, but Andy Dalton, he's gotten them to playoffs. Obviously, they have not won any playoff games.
That's
but
that's a problem.
They've had, what, one losing season since he got there in 2011?
You're talking to a guy who I've defended Marvin Lewis for a decade, and the reality of it is it's just not enough. I think Marvin Lewis competes year in and year out in one of the toughest divisions in football, and here is Hugh Jackson in the toughest division in football. The point I'm bringing up is, one, I'm causing the argument because I think it's something to touch on, that they just have to hit on this pick. They absolutely have they have to hit.
Absolutely.
So I'm going to agree with you. As much part of me really, really could see the Cleveland Browns taking Baker Mayfield here. I just think Baker's ability to take over a game. And look, let me say this something else too. Johnny Manziel and Baker Mayfield are two completely different people.
They have almost zero similarities besides the fact that they are not 6'4", 220.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, I just
that's the only similarity they have.
Yes,
because they're not even built the same. Baker Mayfield, I'm not gonna say he's jacked, but he's in pretty good shape. You know, he's got some meat on his bones for a 6 foot guy. But and they play very different. Johnny Manziel uses feet to set up, to make plays really, and he wasn't a passer. He wasn't gonna sit back there and pass. Mayfield sits back there with anticipation and picks holes in the defense and goes with accuracy. He's not gonna overthrow. He's not gonna, you know, overpower you with his arm, but he has good placement and timing with his passes, and that's something Manziel really struggled with.
He did, and Mayfield can get the ball downfield. If I'm the Cleveland Browns, if I'm playing GM in Cleveland, I'm rolling the dice on Baker Mayfield. Just my two cents. So that's who I'm taking with the number one overall
pick. I probably would too, but
okay.
But I do like Darnold. I think he'll be a good fit. And that's coming from Browns fans. So
you are. Well, let's move on to that number two slot where there's a lot of discussion for what in the hell do the New York Giants do here. Is Eli an old man? The Giants don't know how to pick. Not that they don't know how to pick. They don't often pick in the top five. I think they have three times since the 80s, and it's been picks like Lawrence Taylor, Carl Banks, and Phillip Rivers then traded for Eli Manning. Those are
not bad.
Three great players, two of them Hall of Famers. One of them is going to be a discussion here in a few years. No, not bad at all. So if given the opportunity, that franchise has really done well up top. I don't know what happens here. Jay Glazer made it pretty clear this week that they are not trading out of that pick.
Right. And, you know, I did my own research. I like to look at what, you know, Dave Gettleman's an experienced GM, spending four or five seasons as the GM of the Carolina Panthers.
Sure.
Never traded out of his spot. And I think that's something you have to look at. I think he's going to stick there, take the best player on his board. And I don't think they're going to look at quarterback, even though maybe Sam Darnold might be there. I don't think he will be, but supposedly they like him. I don't think they're going to take a quarterback because you got Eli Manning for, let's say, 2 years. Supposedly they're big on him right now. You got Odell Beckham. Evan Ingram had a good rookie year last year.
He had a very good rookie year.
And then you look at also Dave Gettleman in Carolina. What did he do last year?
Christian McCaffrey.
In the top 10 picks.
Seventh
so there's
overall.
A running back. Yeah, and then you have, he also, I'm trying to think. Sorry, I'm blanking a little bit. But no, what I'm saying is, in an offense, he values the running back as a premier position, and you get one of the best running backs prospects ever in Saquon Barkley staring in your face as number two. From what I'm hearing now, I think they're going to do that. If I was picking, I'd get on the phone with the Buffalo Bills and be like, how bad do you guys want to move up for a quarterback?
Sure.
Let's talk.
Yeah, it probably couldn't hurt to juggle something around, but I think what you've done and the way that we've talked about this leading up to the draft, your strategy has been to really pay attention closely to what these GMs, the actual team GMs, what they've done in the past and how they've handled situations in the past, and you're using that to create a trend to base that on the crystal ball to look into the future and find out what you think these guys might be interested in doing, and I think it's a really good approach because it's telling. Trends are there for you to figure out the future with. It's the best piece of information you can use to put together an educated guess. And I think you're probably right with Gettleman not having an interest in trading out of this spot. But if I were him, I agree with you. You got to get on the phone. You find out, is there anything I can do? And I'm sure they will. I'm sure they'll let the clock wind down quite a bit. I've heard the pundits, the big dogs out there with microphones in front of their face, say that they absolutely have to take a quarterback here. And I completely disagree with that. I disagree with that because I think that Eli Manning and the New York Giants' struggles last year were because Slick, their head coach, was awful. He lost that team in the preseason.
Don't forget, they were a popular pick to go to the Super Bowl.
They were my pick to go to the Super Bowl last year.
Yeah, I do remember that. So
thank you.
You know, they're not far away.
No,
you know, give them a.
I forgot their head coach's name. I forgot who that guy was. What was
back
it? Yeah, I still forgot his name.
You don't need to remember him. I don't think he'll be in the league yet.
I don't think you'll see him anywhere. So
he might have lost that opportunity once he. Eli Manning. So
yeah, what an absolute joke of a head coach that was, and I think that he was really to blame for all of their problems there last year. He lost the team, he lost their attitude, he lost all of it. The year before, that team was competing defensively; they were really good the year before, and Eli was just fine. You added guys like Brandon Marshall. Now he got hurt, but anyhow. I don't think it's that necessary for them to panic and take a quarterback. And I think for the Giants to take a quarterback here at two, it could potentially be a panic. The one thing I don't want to see teams do is reach for a QB in the top 10 if you absolutely don't need one right now. They don't need one now. They've got 2 years of Eli left. They drafted Davis Webb last year. Is that right? Did they draft Davis Webb?
Yeah, and, you know, I've heard that Carolina had him in for a few visits last year with Dave Gettleman at home. I heard Gettleman's a fan of him, so I don't think they're going to go quarterback. I think they're fine with maybe grooming Davis Webb and, you know, seeing what they got there.
Kid wasn't bad at Cal. So, yeah, let's see. I think that the Giants are going to be pretty predictable here. And it's to me, it's pretty difficult to pass up a guy like Saquon Barkley. But don't laugh if they take Bradley Chubb.
Right. They do need an edge rusher. So
yeah, don't laugh if Bradley Chubb gets filled here. Remember, they traded JPP away. Jason Pierre-Paul was sent to Tampa Bay for like a third-round pick, I think.
Yeah, exactly, third round.
I'm a little cloudy on that, but don't be surprised if Bradley Chubb is off the board at two. But if that does, let's keep that in mind moving forward to the New York Jets in the three spot.
So I think they're going to take whoever Cleveland doesn't take.
Yeah.
That Darnold is the preferred passer. Up until now, they don't expect him to be there, and then they will choose between Baker Mayfield and Josh Rosen. But, well, yeah, so let's say Darnold's there. He's the pick. I don't think they even think about it. If Darnold's taken off the board at one with Cleveland, I think the Jets look – I do think they think about it. I think they debate back and forth.
Say that again, please.
It's tough. I do think that they're going to have a debate if it's Mayfield and Rosen, though. I feel like
– if they're both there.
Yeah, and I don't know. I'm trying to think if I'm – I don't know because, okay, I don't really buy into all the immaturity issues with Baker Mayfield, but you have to think how he would be in a place like New York City. And I don't know if they're taking that into account.
They could, but I do think that kid's ready to play.
I do too.
I think he's ready to play football.
If I'm the GM in New York, I'm taking Baker Mayfield. And I think they ultimately will. I just think they're going to have a discussion in the room. And I think that Josh Rosen, I think they're going to have a lot of people in that room that want to take him. But I think Mike McKagan turns the card with the Oklahoma quarterback, Baker Mayfield.
Okay. I'm going to tell you that this is really where I see this breaking down. And I'm going to have to go back to the first pick, second pick, third pick to lay it out. But with that first pick, it's either Mayfield or Darnold. I don't see it going any other direction. The second pick, I really do think the Giants take Bradley Chubb there. I don't want them to because I'd like to see him fall somewhere else, but I think that that's probably a position that they may jump on. It's either Chubb or Barkley for the Giants. So that comes to three with the New York Jets. I think if either Mayfield or Darnold are available at three, Rosen's off the table. I think if either Mayfield or Darnold are there, they're taking one of the two right there. If they're not there, then it's Josh Rosen.
Yeah.
I believe
I think that makes a lot of sense. You don't think Josh Allen there?
No, I don't. Even though the Jets, no, I don't. They haven't drafted an offensive player in the first round since Mark Sanchez.
Oh, yeah.
Go, think about that. They have not taken an offensive player in a first round since 2009 when they took the Sanchez. And the boos that rattled through Madison Square Garden or wherever, Radio City Music Hall, wherever they were probably pretty well warranted. I don't know. Again, I don't know that Josh Rosen is a reach. I do know that his California politics in New York would maybe fit in with that franchise a little bit better with somebody else's. But one of the things these kids got to learn is they got to just shut their mouth and play football.
Yeah,
like it or not, that's their job. That's their job. There's nothing more, nothing less to it. That is their job. So I'm gonna at the three pick. I think like we just discussed, Mayfield, Darnold, Rosen in that order, depending on who's there between Mayfield and Darnold. That changes it all. But moving on to this fourth pick, and the Browns back on the clock, two in the top four really gives them an opportunity to add a lot of help to where they started this last year. And it makes that 0-16 season of struggle worthwhile if they can hit on all these picks in the first three rounds. What do you got it for?
So I know a lot of people claiming for either Barkley or Chubb, whoever lasts till four. I really would think that I think that Chubb would be a great fit lining up with on the other edge of Miles Garrett.
I do too.
You had a very scary pass rush. But yeah, I think you have to look at something else too. You don't have as many holes as you did during the season because we've had a pretty good off season filling a lot of needs. But I would look to trade down. A lot of teams want to come up, get a quarterback. maybe move down to with Buffalo, see what you can get. Because, you know, there's going to be a wrong quarterback. There's going to be a big market for this next quarterback. And I think if you can move down to 12, I know they like Denzel, where they've met with him twice. And I think a guy like Mike McGlinchey, you know, Joe Thomas isn't there anymore.
Yeah.
You just invested a lot of money in a first overall pick, Sam Darnold.
Now get him a left tackle.
Protect him. Yeah. So, and I think McGlinchey's the best in the class, and I think that he would be a really good fit in Cleveland.
Okay. I don't disagree with any of that. I do think that if Bradley Chubb is there and you are the Cleveland Browns and you don't take him, just pack it up. Pack it up, close up shop, go
home. I think
they
will.
Sell the franchise. If he's there, you have to take him.
They will. They're taking best player available at four. So
at four, if you get Bradley Chubb and Myles Garrett within 2 years, you may have the best edge rush in the NFL. The Cleveland Browns haven't had the best anything in the NFL in forever. Right?
I think Chubb's a better prospect than Garrett. If they came out both last year, are they, you know,
it's a possibility.
You guys up right now?
It's a possibility.
They're very on par, and they're really
pretty well towards the end of the season
last year.
Big Ben
and Joe Flacco and Andy Dalton.
You need them. You got to get after the quarterback. So yeah, I see Chubb. Look, that's just the way I see it. If Chubb's not there, I don't really know where they're going. They're not going Saquon Barkley.
I don't think so either. I don't think that'd be smart.
No, I don't either. Let's slide ahead to the Denver Broncos in the number five hole. This team needs a lot.
So they're trading this pick. They're not taking a quarterback. John Elway came out and said he's open to moving down, blah, blah, blah. I don't expect them to keep this pick. And if they do keep it this pick, I think they're going to go O-line. I think they like Quentin Nelson. I think they want to move back. Maybe to get – if they do move back, I don't think they'll get him because I think
they won't
be off by
Tampa
Bay
or
Chicago at 7-8. So I think they can move – I think they will move back with a team like Buffalo or maybe even Arizona. And I think they could focus on maybe the back end, maybe at safety, or I think they have a lot of holes on their offensive line and even linebacker. I don't know. Like we said, they have a lot of holes. I don't know. And I just don't see them addressing quarterback. Everything that I've heard about Case Keenum fitting in well right now with the receivers during.
Yeah, I think I think Case Keenum is buying them time. As a Raider fan, I would hate to see Saquon Barkley end up in Denver. I don't want to stare at him like we do with LaDainian Tomlinson for a decade. It was brutal, and it was hard to watch because Tomlinson just torched the Raiders. I don't want to see it. Don't want to see it at all. But what happens if I tell you that right here, John Elway takes Josh Rosen?
What do I say to that?
Yeah, I don't think it's going to happen. I think if anybody falls in this draft, it's Rosen. That's something I was going to bring up at the end of this broadcast. But I think if anybody is going to tumble down the draft board, it's going to be Josh Rosen. So let's just...
Yeah, I believe it.
Let's just say that Denver make... For the sake of the argument, we can't really add trades into the mock because it would complicate things. But I'm not against the prospect of a trade here. Denver needs offensive line help. I think if McGlinchey's there, that's where they're going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Agree to agree?
Really just any offensive line help they can get, I think they'll benefit from that. I'm not saying that Paxton Lynch and Brock Oswell are good quarterbacks by any means, but I think that part of the reason they've struggled is because, you know, a lot of their O-line has gotten old and injured, and they haven't been able to really sit back there and find their targets. But now that they're you know what I mean.
I do. I also think that if Barkley's there, there's a high possibility that John Elway takes a running back.
I do, too. Yeah. I think that Barkley's off by two, though. I just can't see that. I don't see Gettleman passing on him.
Well, we're going to find out Thursday night. Let's move on to the sixth pick, to the Indianapolis Colts at six.
They're probably my most intriguing team in this draft. They've got so many holes, and they've got a lot of draft capital from the move back from three. And I think they might move back again, but right now what I'm hearing is they love Roquan Smith.
Oh, Jesus.
They think he'll be a leader on the defense. And they know that they can't move past, you know, those three teams at 9, 10, 11 with San Fran, Oakland, and Miami. So I think they might just stick there and take their guy.
I got to tell you what.
I think that if Bradley Chubb is there, they should take him. But I think they want Roquan Smith. Take a look. Go on their depth chart and look at linebacker, and it's kind of painful.
I'm sure it is. That whole roster is pretty painful. I got to tell you what, if I'm the Indianapolis Colts, if I'm Frank Reich, I have major concerns about Andrew Luck's health. I have major concerns. He's still not throwing. They said he's not going to throw at minicamp. It's May in a couple days, and he's not ready to throw yet. This is a problem. Something is wrong with him. He's not healing properly. There's something going on. I don't know what it is, and maybe I'm wrong. Hopefully, for the kid's sake, I am wrong. But something's up. Something's rotten in the state of Denmark, as you Shakespearean folks would say. If I am the Indianapolis Colts, if I am new head coach Frank Reich, I am stomping my feet until you draft me an offensive tackle or a left guard. Quentin Nelson here on the board. If you are the Indianapolis Colts, Quentin Nelson is the most dominant guard I've seen in a long time. Quentin Nelson is your draft pick here. If you pass him, if you take a linebacker, you're openly telling Andrew Luck, well, hey, good luck. You can't let that kid, you can't let him get hit anymore. You've got entirely too much invested in him. You've given him $45 million over the last 5 years or whatever it is, and he's not playing games because he's getting killed. Protect him. It's Quentin Nelson. Let's move on to a team that I hold really, really dear to my toilet bowl, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Sorry, but I hate them.
Hey, yeah. They're another team. They've got a lot of talent in some spots, but a lot of very little talent in others. They need upgrades, D-line, O-line, and safety, especially. Also cornerback. But
they also need upgrades at head coach, defensive coordinator, running back.
General manager.
Yeah, general manager, big time. Please, go ahead.
Some people were saying it's the best or it's the worst kept secret in the draft that Buccaneers, they covet Derwin James. They want to keep him in the state of Florida. They want to bring him down to Tampa. I believe that, but if Quentin Nelson is there, I think I have a hard time believing that happens. Same with Bradley Chubb. Because we're going to see a lot of top-tier guys drop because if we're going to have a run on this quarterback. There could be four quarterbacks in the top five, and that's going to put Tampa Bay in a very interesting spot where they could pick, you know, they might have two of those three guys to pick from with James, Nelson, and Chubb.
Well, Chubb's gone at this point. I'll bet my bottom dollar on this. I'll bet one of my chicken wings at the table while I'm watching it that Chubb is gone at this point.
What if Cleveland, we've talked about, is a fit for Chubb at number four. What if they trade with Buffalo? Buffalo comes to get a quarterback at four. Then we have Denver on the clock.
Then there goes Bradley Chubb to Denver. You know, with the trades, you'll only complicate this, but I think the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, look, in my notes, it says very clearly, this franchise blows, they're taking Derwin James. That's all anybody out there needs to know, man. This franchise blows. They're taking Derwin James.
They're taking him to get better?
They
blow because they're taking him.
They blow because they're taking him. They love the draft within the state of Florida for whatever reason. I get the hometown hero bullshit, but I don't love it. I think that there's a better player out there. Initially, leading up to this, I was a little bit hard on Minka Fitzpatrick, but I do think if you need a safety, that guy's your free safety. That guy's the quarterback of your defense back there, and that was a guy that right away could help you at seven. But I don't know that, you know, because it's seemingly the media types have fallen out of favor a little bit with Fitzpatrick. He's sliding down the boards. Derwin James, 2 years ago, was pretty darn good at Florida State. Last year was not very good. You tell me it's because he was injured.
Yeah, had injury issues.
Now, that's a good reason for you to struggle. And the whole system at Florida State was a mess last year. Let's not forget. That team was a mess.
Oh, that's a big time. I mean, if I'm Derwin James, I know I'm about to get drafted. Jimbo Fisher's good as gone. They didn't care about anything going on there. So, you know, it kind of makes sense. Maybe he – I, yeah, you're right. there's other things that played into the fact that he didn't have his best year.
Right. So maybe he's a better player than I witnessed last year. But I watched him last year, and I saw a guy who looked lost. He wasn't around the football. He didn't show instinct. He didn't show body control. He just didn't look good. I don't want to say the guy looked lazy, because that's not true, but he just didn't look like a top 10 pick.
You know what he does look a little like? He looks scary. He looks just like Cam Chancellor.
Yeah, he's a fine, fair
he's
enough.
He's a very scary strong safety.
Well, and he's going to have to be, because there's some serious talent in the NFC South as far as receiver goes. So
best division in football.
It probably is. As far as receiver go, you got Julio Jones, Michael Thomas. Let's not overlook guys like Ted Ginn, who the last couple of years had great years. Who am I missing? Mohamed Sanu has been a superstar.
Greg Olsen.
Who's the other wide receiver?
He can stay healthy.
The receiver from Michigan in Carolina who really came along? Devin Funchess. Funchess came along pretty well. So, yeah, for the Buccaneers to really try to bolster a secondary early in the draft, I get it. It makes sense. I just don't see this team doing anything right. A couple years ago when they traded back and ended up with Vernon Hargraves, I laughed because I thought, this guy's 5'9". He's not a physical corner. He's not somebody you're going to plug in and be able to cover Julio Jones twice a year. Why? What are you doing?
Right.
It doesn't make sense. And now, again, here you take Derwin James. He cannot play corner in the NFL. He is a safety. And now you still have a 74-year-old Brent Grimes on one side. You have a Vernon Hargraves you're going to slide into the slot so he can just chase people across the field, because that's all he'll do off the ball. I just look, I'm biased. I don't like the Buccaneers. But their best move right here, I think, would be to take Minkah Fitzpatrick. They blow. They're taking Derwin James. Let's move on to the 8th pick, if we can.
So,
Chicago Bears
wants Quentin Nelson to protect Trubisky.
Makes sense.
That makes a lot of sense. Some, as we've talked about, do we think he gets there?
I don't know.
So, if he's there, he's the pick. Other people in the running for the pick, I've heard, is that they would like to get an upgrade on linebacker. I don't think that's a smart move, going with Roquan Smith and Tremaine Edmonds, because, I mean, you just took – here's the thing in the NFL. A GM and head coach only lasts as long as their quarterback does.
That's right. They're tied together, as you said.
They went up to get him last year. You better get him weapons and protect him. So if Quentin Nelson isn't there, stick to Notre Dame's campus. Go Mike McGlinchey. I think that'd be a great fit at left tackle.
I think you're right.
Or right tackle.
I think you're right. I think it gives them some versatility. But what I think is even more important for that Chicago Bears team to do, if their guard or tackle is not there, trade out of the spot.
Oh, yeah.
If they can. Now, I don't know who's going to want to move into 8, because I don't think the team that wants to sneak in here, being the Buffalo Bills, I don't think they have to.
You don't think they have to?
I don't, because the 49ers, the Raiders, aren't taking quarterbacks. The only team that could potentially do that is Miami. Yeah.
And they're going to be like, oh, no, we can't be – if we want Josh Allen or whoever it is flying to 8,
well, I
can't deal with him possibly staying in the division going to Miami.
No.
And then Chicago's going to be like, oh, yeah, Miami's on the other line.
That's right. And I'm on to this, and I think I see what might happen. I'll get to it when we get to that 11 and 12 pick. But I think you're right. I think you're on to it. So the Bears, we agree that they need to go offensive line. If it's not there, they got to get on the phone. They got to make moves. McGlinchey would probably be a great pick if he's there. Mm-hmm. Let's jump to number 9. Let's go McGlinchey at 8, whether he's there or however. And let's go to number 9, the San Francisco 49ers. This team put a quarterback under center on a roster that's not very good, with a head coach that I think is very good. And I think that they turned this all around. They have a big-time problem with a guy by the name of Reuben Foster that they drafted last year.
He won't even be a problem anymore, because he's probably going to get released in the next few months. So.
Well, that's the big problem. He's not there.
Exactly.
And you got to replace
him. You can't count on him. It's practically like they never drafted him. Let's just look at that. So you got to think they look at linebacker again.
I've been
told if Roquan Smith is there, he's the pick. And I've heard if he's not there, then the pick is Tremaine Edmonds. I'm not the biggest fan of Edmonds. I think he's raw. I don't think he's ready right now to be an NFL star.
I agree.
And I would look more so at a player like, like we talked about Garoppolo, a team that wasn't very good. He made them very competitive. You got to get him some receiving weapons. Garcon is kind of old. Marquise Goodwin is a deep vertical threat, but that's about
but
it.
That's it.
What do we think about, like, maybe if they had to move back, go get DJ Moore? Or, I don't know, I would have, who knows if they would take a receiver that early. I don't know if I would, but maybe they take a guy like DJ Moore or Calvin Ridley at 9.
I think this is John Lynch's opportunity, that John Lynch has proved to us last year that he is willing to get on the phone and play games with people. And the game John Lynch is going to play is going to be with three teams. It's going to be with the Miami Dolphins, the Buffalo Bills, and the Washington Redskins. The Oakland Raiders need a defensive tackle. They're on the clock at 10. They would love Vita Vey. The Washington Redskins love him too. The Washington Redskins need to stop the run in that division. They need to create some big meat up front. They got to do something. If I'm John Lynch, this Tremaine Edwards kid's, yeah, you know what? He jumps off the tape. He's fast. He's strong. He's all these things, but he's 19 years old. You are not plugging him in at the NFL level and expecting him to be the quarterback of that defense. It's not happening.
No way.
There's just no way. Thank you for agreeing with me. It's just not happening. He is 19 years old. He is not going to just jump in and be that stud right away. Now, in 3 years, is he going to be great? Possibly. But for a team that's building in San Francisco, sure, that's great. But I'd rather get his first contract out of that. I don't want it if I'm the 49ers. They're on the phone. They're going to make a trade potentially with somebody. I think the Buffalo Bills are going to be in a little bit of a panic mode here.
Oh, yeah.
Because they want their guy. They're going to do something to get him. I don't know what it is they're going to do, but they're going to do something. Let's just say, for the sake of the discussion, you are the San Francisco 49ers. You get on the phone to the Buffalo Bills, and you break the bank with the Bills. The Bills move up to the 9 spot, and the Bills take Josh Allen.
I think that's very realistic. Because, you know, you trade. People forget about this, but think about the offseason Buffalo's had. So, you know, we could see last season that Sean McDermott, Brandon Bean, Tyrod Taylor is not their guy. You know, they benched him, Brian
right.
Peterman, and we know how that went. So, but this offseason, you know, they trade Tyrod Taylor to Cleveland, get a third-round pick. Okay, so now your quarterback's Nathan Peterman, and then you go on a free agency and get AJ McCarron. But it's very well known around the league you want a quarterback. You got 2 picks at 21 and 22. But then you package that 21st pick with Cordy Glenn, your left tackle, and trade to Cincinnati. So now you moved up and got more draft capital with pick 12 and 22. So you got 2 first-rounders. But then Eric Wood and Richie Incognito retire.
Sure.
So they've got a lot of holes on the offensive line to protect whoever is going to be back there at quarterback. And when you made all of these moves, you traded your left tackle so you could go better get – what do you think, a linebacker? No, they're
no
going
way.
To get a quarterback.
No
so,
way.
So, yeah, someone's going to get on the phone and be like, oh, yeah, so-and-so is on the other line. They said they're about to move up. They'll give us this and this and this. So, yeah, I do think that they're going to get – they are going to break the bank with somebody in the top 10 to go move up to take. And like I said before, I think their guy's Josh Allen. He's kind of similar to the stature and the athleticism, arm power that Cam Newton had. And Sean McDermott and Brandon Bean had that in Carolina with him. They had a lot of success going to the Super Bowl, so I could see that being an ideal fit.
I think that's what happens.
An ideal trade partner could be San Francisco at 9.
I think it is, because then the 49ers can get a couple more picks. Like you said, Buffalo's got the trade capital to do it. The 49ers open up some spots for them down the line. They need a linebacker, but Tremaine Edmonds is not the kid that's going to jump in and help them right away. So he's going to fall back a little bit. So at 9, you've got Josh Allen stepping into that place with the Buffalo Bills. Going on to 10, Roquan Smith is what everybody sees happening with the Oakland Raiders. Man, John Gruden doesn't want to take a linebacker in the top 10.
You think he's making the call? Where's McKenzie? For
everything I've read says McKenzie and Gruden are on the same page as far as this goes.
What do you think, O-line?
You know, they need a right tackle badly. If McGlinchey's there, they need a tackle badly because Penn is done in a year or so, or a year.
Yeah.
This draft isn't exactly loaded with great offensive tackles, though.
Not at all.
So I think reaching for a guy, you're not reaching for him, but at 10, fill another gap with a linebacker. I don't want the Raiders to take Tremaine Edmonds. I don't. I think if they think this is a team that's going to win 10 games now, a 19-year-old kid moving in is not going to help you. I would really love to see them get some beef right here and put Vea at 10.
He's one of my favorite players.
The guys, look, he's stout, he's strong, he's a plug. Good teams have great defensive lines. Great defensive lines stop the run. They change the RPO that is the new fancy pants in the NFL. I think Vea changes the way the NFL works. I think if you put a guy like Roquan Smith behind the Raiders' middle defensive line, he's going to get beat up at the second level an awful lot. And
yeah.
I don't know, you know, beyond Mack on one side and Mario Edwards on the other, those guys are pretty good. Eddie Vanderdoes, defensive tackle, played well last year, but he's really injured, had trouble staying on the field. Roquan Smith, go watch. I watch a lot of SEC football. Roquan Smith wasn't that good at the second level. He wasn't. If guards got upfield, if anybody got to him, he got pushed around.
Yeah, that's the thing. He is a great blitzer.
Yeah.
He's good coming across the line of scrimmage if he's untouched.
Yeah.
If a guard or tackle gets him on the second level, he kind of gets buried in the blocks. He doesn't have great hand placement to get off those blocks because he's not a very big guy. He's probably, what, 225?
Yeah, he's
225.
He's not so the prototype.
If that. So, yeah, and don't get me wrong, he brings a lot of energy from everything I've heard. He's a great leader.
Yeah.
Some guy that's going to be able to be a great leader and great motivator for guys on the team and zero off-field concerns, which obviously we know that is important. But, yeah, I'm not as high as other people are. Yeah, but you know, in the right system where he can play maybe as a weak side linebacker and not get many blocks and just scrape over the middle and get tackles, that'd be great.
Well, that being said, you and I agree to agree. I like Roquan Smith. I think he's going to be a good football player, but I do think the Oakland Raiders with the 10th overall pick, believe it or not, this team needs a safety. They're taking Minka Fitzpatrick here.
Oh, no, I do not agree with you on that.
I said believe it or not, you may not, but I think they're taking Minka. I think they're taking Minka Fitz. I think that Reggie Nelson is there.
You think he's a safety?
Yeah, I do. I think he's going to be a free safety.
Even though he's telling guys at the combine, he's telling teams at the combine that he'd prefer to play nickelback because you know that's one thing, he's very versatile. They asked him, "Where do you see yourself fitting in an NFL roster?" He said, "I think I'm the perfect nickel."
Well, I think that's a big time problem because nickelbacks don't get paid in the NFL.
That too, yeah, and you're not going to use a top 10 pick on him.
It's not happening.
So if that's why I have him falling.
I think
bit.
He's a free safety all day. So
well, he's very.
We can agree to disagree.
Well, you've got. No, correct me if I'm not. You watch way more Raiders football than I do.
I do.
Is Carl Joseph a strong or free safety?
He's a strong safety, and he played well. Now, last year at one point, he got removed from the field for a mental mistake.
Yeah.
Came back on the field.
I like Carl Joseph.
I do too. He came back on the field and he corrected the mental mistake. I blame a lot of the mental mistakes in the secondary on that defense last year on a coaching staff that was piss effing poor.
Well, here's the thing. Now we talk about Carl Joseph, and then we haven't talked about Gerrion Conley. 3 years, three first round picks, all in the secondary. I don't know. I don't know if that's the best idea. I think that what you said earlier, with Vita Vea, I think he'd be an ideal fit there. I think even a linebacker. I think D-line, linebacker, offensive line, you have to be for Oakland.
I agree, but that doesn't mean that that's what they're going to do. I find John Gruden being bored with a defensive tackle. I'd love to see him take Vita Vea at 10. I don't know that that's the case. I feel like it will either be Vea or Fitzpatrick. I don't know. You know what? Look, I see all the Denzel Ward falling to him. I don't know that Denzel Ward's there at 10.
Yeah, I've heard Chicago likes him, but they didn't. It's hard to find guys like that a fit. I think that Denzel Ward could go maybe even next at Miami at 11.
Well, let's move on to Miami because we're up against the clock already.
So, yeah, Miami, I think that we just talked about a lot of guys that could go there if a quarterback doesn't fall to them, if they don't go get a quarterback. But I think guys like Denzel Ward, Tremaine Edmonds, Roquan Smith, I've heard Roquan Smith's their guy. If he's there, they're going to be picked. We don't think he'll be there. So, and I that in that case, they also want to get another linebacker, so Tremaine Edmonds for there. And then also Vita Vea, you know, they just got rid of Sue, so he's an ideologically, you know, he's an ideal fit
sure.
to fill that void that just left.
At the gap. No, I don't disagree. I do think, though, that you will see the defensive tackle fall off the board there to the Miami Dolphins as well. I don't see them taking a quarterback. I don't see them taking Lamar Jackson there. I really don't. I think they're in a quarterback market. I don't see the reach for Lamar Jackson at 11. I just don't see it. I think Josh Allen may be a bit of a reach as well, but it's going to remain to be seen. But we've got San Francisco falling back into this 12 spot. Let's just say Roquan Smith is there for the Dolphins. That's their guy. They're taking Roquan Smith. Moving back to 12, where the San Francisco 49ers are. Remember, they traded that 9 spot to the Buffalo Bills. I think if you're the San Francisco 49ers, you need weapons. You've got Garoppolo. You need some offensive talent. What do you do here?
Here? I'm a Calvin Ridley guy. I like Calvin Ridley. I think he's the best route runner in the draft. He gets open. Pairing him with Garoppolo would be really good. Do I think that's what they do? No. If they picked a receiver, I think they like DJ Moore.
Okay.
And okay. I've heard they like Cortland Sutton too. So.
Okay. But
again, if a linebacker falls, if they move back to three spots and still get the linebacker they want, the linebacker that's high on the board, I still think they take.
Well, Tremaine Edmonds is still on the board here at this point at 12.
And I think they'll take him at 12.
I do too.
I wouldn't personally, but I think they would.
They're
in panic mode because they were one of the worst linebacking cores when Reuben Foster got hurt last year, and now they know. I mean, they can't.
A couple years ago, they took a kid by the name of Chris Borland in the later rounds, maybe the second or third round, and that kid was playing really, really well until he decided that for his health he was going to step away from the game. So don't put it past John Lynch to try to find another linebacker later in the draft and take Calvin Ridley there just to give somebody a weapon. Garoppolo needs weapons.
Yeah.
We're really up against clock, so we're going to slide through here to 13, the Washington Redskins.
Yeah. All offseason long, I've been preaching they really need to improve their run defense, and why not put a guy that weighs 340 pounds on that defense at nose tackle? I think Vita Vea is a perfect fit.
Yeah, and that's who they want. If Vea is there, if he gets past the Raiders, if he gets past the Dolphins, I think Vita Vea is exactly what the Redskins do. I'm going to agree to agree. Following them is the Green Bay Packers on the board. Green Bay needs things. They need defensive play. They need defensive help badly. They've got issues at corner. They've got issues at the edge.
Morgan Burnett's gone too, so they have a safety problem, and they trade it. So I look at a guy like if Derwin James gets past Tampa Bay, I think this is a spot.
Okay.
But other than that, I think that Denzel Ward, this could be a landing spot for him. I think they could go corner again. And I've heard a lot of maybe a Harold Landry or Marcus Davenport because Clay Matthews isn't the Clay Matthews he was a few years ago.
No, he's not. But it would be nice.
They need to get after the passer better.
Yeah, they do. It would be very nice to put a Marcus Davenport up front and see if you can get an edge rush. It would be very nice. Don't be surprised if he ends up in Oakland, though. Let's slide to 15.
Oh, yeah, they like him.
They do, and I see why. He's kind of explosive, but we've got a few minutes. So, to 15, this, to me, is one of the most intriguing spots on the board, and that is the Arizona Cardinals. What do they do here?
I mean, you'd think quarterback. So, you know.
Sam Bradford's just a bridge. He's a bridge.
Oh, yeah, and they did that on purpose. I could definitely see Lamar Jackson. And, you know, they have a lot of other holes, too. I could definitely see offensive tackle. I think this is Mike McGlinchey. I think if Mike McGlinchey gets past those teams we're talking in the top 10, 11, 12, I think this is his, you know, this is the farthest he'll move. And I think that if he's there and if the quarterback that Arizona doesn't want, that they'll go McGlinchey.
Well, not everybody can take Mike McGlinchey, though. He's already off the board.
Oh, I know. No, that's what I'm saying. Well, if he's not, what I'm saying is if he's not off the board and the quarterback they don't want, this is that's who they're going to go with. They need offensive line help. But, you know, you'd think that they're going to be looking to move up. But if not, I mean, Lamar Jackson is on the board.
Barf. Yeah, I think it's possible. I also think that there's a good possibility that this team takes a wide receiver. They need a quarterback. You've got 5-year QBs off the board at this point in all likelihood. Sam Bradford, he's just a stopgap guy. I've got them taking Calvin Ridley.
I think Calvin Ridley would be a great guy to learn from Larry Fitzgerald.
I think so, too. I think you put a route runner with one of the greatest route runners of all time, and that's just nothing but moving forward. And speaking of which, the 16th pick, the Baltimore Ravens, another bird on the board. They don't have a wide receiver. They just don't. And every year
tell you something, though.
They keep going to the free agent market and getting old receivers.
Well, people forget they took Breshad Perriman.
Yeah, and he's never been healthy.
So, yeah, that's why I don't think they trust the wide receiver. I don't think they trust first-round wide receivers because of that. And you can look at, in the past few years, first-round wide receivers aren't as productive as they should be. You know, you got Josh Doctson, Laquon Treadwell.
Well,
Corey Coleman from 2016, those guys are kind of eh.
Yeah, they took a little bit of time, but I think right there in their own backyard, they got a kid by the name of DJ Moore.
You could, but I don't think they're going to go receiver. Because, you know, look, they just got, what's his face? They just got Willie Snead signed over.
Old and useless.
I'm not saying that, but I'm saying they've done a lot in free agency to address that position. You know, they got Michael Crabtree. I don't know how you feel about him.
Ah,
he's
still a good player.
Yeah, so they got him. And then, you know, they've also been rumored for Dez Bryant. We'll see if that happens. But I just think that they'll wait on receiver.
Dez isn't signed anywhere till after the draft.
I agree. But I don't think that they're going to be like I've said before, these receivers at the top of this draft aren't – you know, anything special. They're not like top level guys. There's none that look exactly elite. So
no, I don't see one either.
Very good. There's a very good amount of day two guys that could bring a lot to a team. And I think that they would just rather do that. I think they have a hole at right tackle. And then I think they also have a hole at tight end. And this is where I think the first tight end could come off the board. So what do they really like? Hayden Hurst. And okay. I think they could either take him here or move back a few picks for somebody who wants to move up for maybe, like we just said, if Marcus Davenport. I think Detroit really likes him. They could move back to 20 and take Hurst there and let them come get Davenport.
We've got to move on to the 17th pick, and that's the San Diego Chargers. I don't care what they do.
They've snooped around quarterbacks too, but I don't know if they're going to get one at 17. I think that there's one thing I know for a fact. They need another defensive lineman inside next to Corey Leggett, who is also suspended for 4 games.
Right.
So I think if Vita Vea gets past Washington, he's there.
He's not going to be there.
If not,
I will guarantee
Deron
he's
Payne
not going to be there.
Out of Alabama would be a great fit, I think.
I think that's your play right there.
And then Taven Bryan also. But then they've also got a hole at safety. But I think they'll in the first round, they'll go defensive tackle.
Sounds good. Sounds right. How about to the Seattle Seahawks at 18? This is a team that's in a complete and total rebuilding mode. I don't care what anybody says. They've got problems. Yeah. They're not what they
used
to be.
They're screwed.
Yeah, they are. And teams like this, I think you just start to build. And if I'm this team, I start to build from the middle out. But they need some help on the outside. They're going to have to cover some receivers and that. I see them finding a kid like Josh Jackson out of Iowa.
Yeah, I think Josh Jackson would be a really good fit for the way that their cornerbacks have played. You know, very aggressive. I mean, Jackson had 8 picks last year.
Yeah, so he's a physical, good ball player.
Tall, lanky. He kind of fits in that mold of a rate of, you know, they're not there anymore, really, but the Legion of Boom. So
that's over with.
Maybe a new Legion of Boom.
Well, maybe
Josh Jackson.
At 19, we have the Cowboys, the Dallas Cowboys. This is a team that for years you thought, boy, they could be something this year, and year in and year out, they just aren't there. I don't know what they're doing at 19. The Cowboys need help all over the place. But on this board, there's a receiver there that they got to take somebody. This team has nobody to throw the ball to.
Yeah, they got Allen Hurns, but I don't know about
again,
what you think about that. That's
he was
not,
a number two
number
in
one.
He was a number two in Jacksonville. Yeah,
I think they do look at receiver. Whoever's there, I don't know, DJ Moore, Cortland Sutton, and then a kind of a sleeper pick for them. I've heard they really like Leighton Vander Esch out of Boise State. They've got another hole at linebacker with Anthony Hitchens signing with Kansas City. And, he'd be kind of a good understudy to learn from a guy like Sean Lee.
Sure, but...
And I think that he could be a good fit.
Are they going to do that in the top 20?
I think they could, yeah.
Remains
to be
seen.
There's a lot of talent in day two of the draft for receivers, and I don't know if a team like Dallas is going to want to reach for that when they have other holes to fill.
Well, Wolf, we're going to finish up here with the 20th overall pick, just to appease the clock here, but... At 20 overall is the resurgent upstart Detroit Lions with their new head coach and my twin brother, Matt Patricia. This is a team that, look, year in and year out, I think this is a good football team. Matt Stafford is a very good quarterback. They need pass rush help. You can always add some receiving help. But again, if you want to talk day two wide receivers, they're out there. Has this team ever had a running game?
With Barry Sanders.
Yeah. It was a little while ago. It was just a little while ago. Oh, I don't know what they do. They need help up front. You got a new head coach who is a defensive guy. I do think this. I think that a guy like Matt Patricia, who grew up and cut his teeth in the Bill Belichick system, is going to covet one thing that was very important to those very, very good Super Bowl champion Patriot teams, and that was big meatballs like Vince Wilfork in the middle. They always had that big plug that just took over the defensive line. Look at these teams that win year in and year out. They've got a big monster in the middle. I think that if I am the Detroit Lions and Matt Patricia, he is going to channel his inner Bill Belichick and find himself a defensive tackle with meat. This might be where your boy Tavon Bryan from the University of Florida comes in.
Yeah, I could definitely see him there.
Big Daddy Daron Payne.
Yeah, they would definitely be a help next to A'shaun Robinson, who's actually, kind of turned himself into a good pro. But I'm going to stick with a different position on the defensive line. Ziggy Ansah, we don't know if he's going to be around after this season.
Right.
They signed a one-year deal. But even not, they need a pass rusher opposite him. And you got Harold Landry and Marcus Davenport. Davenport is the guy they would really want. Kind of, I would compare him exactly to Ansah. Both raw players, lanky, but also very, he's 6'7", 280-ish. So I think that would be almost a perfect situation for him to learn from Ansah and maybe line up on the other side of him.
Okay. All right. Well, listen, due to time constraints, man, that's 1 through 20. Let's go ahead and wrap this up. Who is, if you had to look into your crystal ball down the line, who's the bust of this first round? Who's the one guy that somebody's going to take and in 3 years you're going to go, what were we doing? Who's the one guy? Or two?
Yeah, let me think about that. So
think about it, and next week when we do a recap, let's go through it and see who you think the bust of the draft might be. I think...
Wait,
go ahead.
Let me... I actually think... In the wrong situation, Roquan Smith will be a surprising bust.
Okay, I agree.
Because he's not big enough to take on all those blocks at the second level, and you're going to have to get somebody up front, big and meaty, that's not going to let guys go get him.
Right. Well, I have issues with... I have issues with a handful of these defensive players in the draft, particularly the linebackers. The corners, there seem to be so many cornerbacks year in and year out. And last year you found out right away if they were any good. And there was a few guys that were just on the scene and great. I don't know. You don't know until they're set into what you mentioned before, which I think is very important. You don't know until they're set into a situation. with the right coach, the right scheme, the right time, the right place, and it all comes together. And voila, you have Marcus Lattimore, who was far and away probably one of the best cornerbacks in the league last year, if not the best cornerback in the league last year. Is that fair to say?
I mean, very fair.
I mean, the guy was a superstar. He fell right into place. Dennis Allen, defensive coordinator in New Orleans, did a tremendous job with young talent on that team. Don't laugh one day when Dennis Allen gets a second crack at it as a head coach. But as much as I really want to go through these next 12 spots, I don't have the time for it. But I will say this. We went 1 through 20, and we really didn't find a home for a big name in this draft, and that's Lamar Jackson.
Yeah, he's the wild card. I think there's a list of 10 teams that could be possible fit. It's really hard to predict. In my latest mock draft, you know, I had the Chargers come get him because, you know, they had meetings with all these quarterbacks. I think they're looking to find a heir to.
And Lamar Jackson is the only one that's going to be there. He's the only one that's going to be there for the Chargers.
Yeah. So, you know,
would you shit if the Chargers traded up for Josh Rosen?
I think that'd be a great fit for Josh Rosen.
I do, too. He stays in his home city. He sits behind Philip Rivers.
Learn a lot from Philip Rivers. And that's where I think they want to take a guy before Philip Rivers retires, because Philip Rivers is a great pro. He's going to teach a rookie how to be a professional, how to be a professional quarterback.
He's going to be the lighthouse. He's going to be the beacon. He's going to be what somebody can look at, I think. I completely think you're right. How about the Pittsburgh Steelers, since everybody out there, we got a bunch of listeners that are Steeler fans. What are they doing at 28?
So, of course, with the unfortunate injury to Ryan Shazier, who knows what's going to happen there, but it doesn't look promising in the linebacker position. From everything I'm hearing, if Leighton Vander Esch falls to 28, I think that's they're going to be pick him.
Who?
But if not, I think there's
who?
No Leighton Vander Esch out of Boise State.
Thank you.
But if it's not him, then you know, stick at linebacker Rashawn Evans from Alabama would be a good fit in that defense. And the sleeper for them I have is Darius Geis, because kind of similar to Le'Veon Bell, and who knows if they're going to finally sign Le'Veon Bell to a long-term contract.
I don't see how you don't give Le'Veon Bell money, but I also see how you don't give Le'Veon Bell money. Darius Geis is a downhill runner. He likes to lower his head down and run people over. I mean, I get it. I've heard rumors that if Lamar Jackson is there, the Pittsburgh Steelers would show interest. I think that's crazy.
I heard that, too. I don't think he'll be there, though.
I don't either.
I think that the Steelers are a type of team where they feel like, because let's be honest, in the NFL, all these guys are great athletes. They're good football players. I feel like the Steelers pride themselves in being in a good organization and coaching their players to be the ultimate pro and being the Steeler way, just like the Patriot way, where if they brought in Lamar Jackson, I feel like they could teach him a lot, kind of how Ben Roethlisberger is.
I'm not buying any of it. I'm not buying any of the Steeler way. The Steeler way is Joey Porter on the sidelines acting like a jackass.
I never
Steeler
said it
way,
was the right way, but hey, does it win?
It wins because they're talented. It wins because Antonio Brown's a superstar. It wins because Le'Veon Bell's amazing.
We've talked about fit. You think Antonio Brown would be a star with the Browns if he was drafted by the Browns in 2010 in the fifth round?
No.
he's gotten to where he is. I will tell you, he's gotten to where he is because, one, he's a very hard worker. I will not take that away from
you
him.
You can't,
You know, he's landed in a great situation with the Steelers where they take a lot of these mid-round guys and turn them into stars.
Yeah, they
it's
do.
A great situation
no, look, they
and
do.
I think
Mike
Lamar
Wallace
Jackson could benefit from it.
Mike Wallace is a perfect example. The moment they let him go, he fell apart. But on that note, man, we used up the whole clock here today, homie. We're all done. We got to move on. But for those of us, welcome us back, man. Give us a click. Go out there and check Mike out on at FTD365.com. Is it FantasyTalkDaily365.com? All the way across.
Football Talk Daily.
Excuse me. Yeah, Football Talk Daily at three. Football Talk Daily.
Do it. Sorry. Yeah. We got a website, FootballTalkDaily365.com. And then if you like what we have out there, go ahead and give us a follow on Twitter at FTD365.
All right, Mike. I appreciate it, man. Keep up the good work. Enjoy the draft Thursday night.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, my pleasure, man. It's good to get back on the air. It's good to get football season rolling again, and this is time when we start talking. So let's look forward to getting back on here once we have a draft breakdown. We know what we're talking about. We know what we're looking at. And let's go back through and evaluate what teams did, if they helped themselves, if they didn't. And, again, everybody out there, man, we thank you guys for listening, tuning in, always being part of the game, part of the show. You're listening to The Line Sports Talk. Check us out on Twitter at TL317. Mr. Mike, thanks again, buddy. Everybody else out there, thank you. Good night. Go enjoy the draft. Be safe.